Hello, I will be doing my revolution on the Chinese Revolution of 1949. Before we get into this, I'd like to explain what communism is.
Communism is a political and economic system in which major productive resources in a society, such as mines, factories, and farms, are owned by the state. Now, all this wealth is divided among the people in the state equally according to an individual's need.
The major causes of the Chinese Revolution, as with many revolutions, were economic. The Chinese people became very frustrated with the increasing amount of money that was required to meet their tax debts. The Chinese Revolution was a result of social, economic, and political changes in China. Chinese economies was dominated by agriculture. Crops were there, but their practices were outdated and their techniques were old. The Kuomintang government was established by Sun Yat-sen in 1922. He wanted to build a modern, unified, and prosperous China and wanted a cooperative alliance with the Communist Party.
Once Sun Yat-sen dies, essentially the power of the KMT government goes into the hands of the Chiang Kai-shek. And he starts to consolidate power right from the get-go. He doesn't intentionally try to antagonize the communists. But around 1927, he's starting to merge these various factions in China.
Now, during this time, there were many arguments between the communists and the nationalists. Chiang Kai-shek was saying, "We are better. We are the ones that unify China." And the communists are saying, no. We are the ones that are better and can unify China. As many years go by, there's still discrepancy between the nationalists and the communists. And Chiang Kai-shek almost has them defeated. And in the Chinese history, there's a famous event called the Long March. And they marched through extremely tough terrains all the way to northwest of China. During this time, Mao Zedong became leader of the Chinese Communist Party and led the Red Army through northwest China. It was during this long march when Mao Zedong really started to show his leadership during the retreat to northwest China. And this is what really allowed Mao Zedong to have control of the Chinese Communist Party. Only the beginning, I'm only getting started. I don't mind digging, baby, I'll work hard. I've been in the ashes, singing from the garden. Under Mao and the Communists, China was transformed from an agricultural society into an industrial society. Mao eliminated the old landlord and business classes and provided free healthcare for peasants. Mao also instituted reform that made women legally equal to men, although in practices this was never achieved. China was transformed into a one-party dictatorship with Mao in total control. Similar to the Soviet Union, China never completely fulfilled the promises.
You see, now one day I'll be running this place, and one day I could take you away. But I want you to wonder what's my name, 'cause I need you to want me to sing. 'Cause when you saw me out your window, you sang.
First, the fact that the Chinese people have been subjected to a ruthless dictatorship for 60 years is not justified. However, the revolution itself, it was completely justified. Following the collapse of the old imperial rulers, the Chinese did form a democratic republic under Sun Yat-sen. However, by the end of the 1920s, that hopefully start had been portrayed by the nationalists, who assumed the government and instituted a regime that is notable for its corruption. Mao Zedong was sincere in wanting to heal and rebuild China, and certainly many of his followers did not realize that communism can't end up being anything other than a dictatorship when you put it into practice. This short video will be a recap on the Chinese Revolution of 1949.
The world's most populous nation had been in political turmoil since the early 1900s. Centuries of rule by feudal emperors and warlords had failed, and a civil war had raged between the communist forces of Mao and nationalist forces of Chiang Kai-shek since 1927. Though both sides had banded together to fight the Japanese invasion, the end of World War II brought the return of civil war. Now China, the Celestial Empire, was about to change forever. The civil war in China ends with communist victory. In January, Beijing, China's historic capital, is surrendered to the communists. A social revolution in rural China has helped the party gain momentum during the war, as many peasants joined the movement because of the promise of land redistribution. With increasing communist support among the poor and decreasing support for the nationalists from the U.S., Mao Zedong's army is set to claim victory. Although the nationalists are not prepared to surrender, when peace talks break down, the communist army crosses the Yangtze River virtually unopposed, prepared to take Nanking, Hankou, and Shanghai.
Nanking, capital of China, nervously awaits the communist army encamped only 10 miles outside the city. Only Chiang Kai-shek's successor, acting president Lai Chung-yen, and Chu Chiang-wei, his chief advisor, remain in the city to represent the government. Their mission is to seek peace with the communists, acknowledged victors in the 22-year-old civil war. In the beleaguered city itself, the feeling runs high in favor of unconditional surrender.
Eventually, the communists take over all of mainland China. Only the islands of Hainan, Taiwan, and a few scattered areas are still in nationalist hands.
5 months ago, the troops of Mao Zedong marched into Shanghai unopposed. That victory was celebrated in July at a gigantic parade in what is today the largest red city in the world, now so isolated that these pictures took 3 months to reach Britain. In those 3 months, the Reds have changed the face of China and brought the world's largest country within the communist empire.
On October 1st, Mao Zedong establishes the People's Republic of China. Though the largest population in the world was now under Mao's leadership, the United States and the West continued to recognize only Chiang Kai-shek.